Thank you for plugging into this Family Life News podcast, streaming issues-driven, family-focused news.
Welcome back to another edition of Capital Connection. Fridays during the noon report, we give you direct connection to what's happening in Albany and Harrisburg with the experts on the issues at the state capitals. They are Jason McGuire with New Yorkers for Constitutional Freedoms and Michael Geer at the Pennsylvania Family Institute. Gentlemen, we've been off for a couple of weeks, but there is much to discuss. Jason, we'll start with you and the latest scandal to rock Albany, the resignation of Lieutenant Governor Brian Benjamin, accused of public corruption. The question is, how much will this hurt Governor Hochul?
Yeah, we're going to know within the next 2 weeks or so how deeply that wound is going to cut. If Brian Benjamin can come off the ticket and Governor Hochul can replace him with a person of her choosing, then it may not be that damaging. But if his name remains on the ballot after that May 3rd deadline to remove his name, that could be devastating to her campaign going forward.
Now, speaking of May, Michael, we talk a lot in elections about October surprises. Are you anticipating any May surprises leading up to those big primary races for U.S. Senate and governor, especially when it comes to the Republican races?
Well, I think so. I mean, it's hard to know for sure to predict what's going to happen. Already Donald Trump has weighed in on some races here in both the U.S. Senate and the gubernatorial race, which was a bit of a surprise in terms of where he came down on that. There's so much money being spent on these races, especially in the U.S. Senate race, that who knows what's being dug up by opposition research and things that they may spring here at the last minute. Of course, now we have early voting here in Pennsylvania with the mail-in ballots, so that means if it's going to be a surprise, it needs to come a little earlier than it used to.
Yeah. Now that the state budget, Jason, all $220 billion worth, has been adopted, a lot of folks wonder, what now in Albany? What do these guys do now till the end of the session in June?
Well, June 2nd is when session technically ends, and there are primaries this year, so I expect they'll get out of there quickly. Between now and then, our organization is watching a number of things. One, we're trying to block a mandate for students to receive COVID vaccination to attend school. That could be problematic for a lot of faith-based schools in particular across the state. We're also working to protect pregnancy centers. There is legislation that would unfairly target them we're working to block, as well as trying to stop a statewide sex ed mandate. That's, again, rearing its head here in the Empire State.
We're also expecting in June, Michael, that big decision on Dobbs v. Jackson, the case that could unravel Roe. Why are so many states acting now to restrict abortion? And then conversely, you see states like Connecticut doing the opposite. Why are they acting now ahead of that ruling?
Well, the whole concept of Roe versus Wade being overturned in the Dobbs case means that the issue of abortion gets returned back to the states. And so there's some states that already have laws in place called trigger laws that if Roe is overturned, abortion would become much more restricted. Other states don't have necessarily laws on the books that would do that, so that's why some legislatures in conservative states or in red states are moving towards further restrictions on abortion. But as you said, states like Connecticut and even Maryland and others are going whole hog in the other direction in a terrible way in terms of allowing abortions up until the moment of birth and even in California proposal, even after birth.
Yeah. Let's talk about the pandemic, Jason. The governor promising no more lockdowns, no more shutdowns, no matter how much the subvariant spread and it's spreading. Do you believe her? Can we take her at her word?
Well, I think we can believe the governor for a number of reasons. One, the subvariants do seem to be much more mild than what we experienced in 2020. And let's not forget there is an election coming up and people are grown weary of the mandates. And so I don't anticipate the governor will put new mandates out regarding shutdowns, though I did allude to earlier a vaccine mandate, and that's something to watch through the end of this session.
Yeah, we can't talk about this topic, Michael, without mentioning what's happening in Philadelphia. Absolutely unbelievable. So much mass confusion there. I want you to hear a snippet here from correspondent Tom Costello from NBC News, and then I'll have you weigh in.
In Philadelphia, for example, you can fly on a plane unmasked, but in the airport terminal, mask goes back on. Take the subway or an Uber, mask can come off, but go grab dinner or do some shopping in the city, mask up again.
Yeah, we saw that federal judge's ruling that has lifted the mask mandate at the airports, but in Philadelphia, all bets are off. I can't seem to make sense of this. What's driving the decision-making there in Pennsylvania's largest city?
It's all about politics. I mean, the University of Pennsylvania, their public health department had recommended against any mask mandate in Philadelphia, yet the city's mayor and the health department decided to impose this this mandate. Makes no sense, both on numbers as well as what we know about masks. It's the only city in the country that's doing this, and it's all about politics.
Yeah, we're seeing Disney's disdain for DeSantis in Florida. Jason, when it comes to, you know, gender identity, ideology, and how it's being rammed down the throats of children, New Jersey, one of the latest states to try to shove this as a sexual orientation indoctrination that's going on at school. What's the latest on this front in New York State?
Well, there is a renewed effort to try to mandate comprehensive sex education in public schools across the state. That's why our organization is partnering with our friends at Feed My Sheep in something we're calling the Center for Childhood Innocence, an effort to really raise awareness of this issue and push back on legislative efforts to really instruct kindergartners and upward on just very inappropriate subject matter.
Yeah, there is a bill, I think she was a Rochester state senator, if I'm not mistaken, that had sponsored legislation to this effect. Whatever happened to that?
That's the bill we're talking about. Senator Samra Brook was Rochester, Naples, bit of the Finger Lakes region, is sponsoring that legislation, and we're working to stop that bill as we head towards that June 2nd end of session date.
Yeah, so many parents, Michael, are so up in arms over what's happening at schools. The Pennsylvania State of Education report went public last week. It showed that public school enrollment down by about 30,000, while homeschooling and charter schooling numbers are going in the opposite direction. I think I know the answer to this, but if you would, what's driving this trend?
Well, it's awareness that has come into the households of by families seeing what's happened through the COVID shutdowns with online learning, as well as then what's been in the news with just what Jason was just talking about, in inappropriate sex education in classrooms, as well as CRT and other things are causing parents to say, hey, wait a minute, this system, this public school system is not serving my children well, and I'm looking for other options, homeschooling being a key one of those.
All right, we're going to talk one more education issue with you, Michael, in a minute. But first, more politics. Rob Astorino, who's no stranger to the world of politics in New York, has a beef with Lee Zeldin, many calling the presumptive Republican gubernatorial nominee. Astorino accusing Zeldin of trying to get his name off the June primary ballot. How much is there to this in New York State heading into that primary?
Well, I think right now candidates are trying to get whatever opportunities they have to get their name in the news, and that's certainly happening. It's a common practice that once petitions are submitted for each campaign to go through and make sure those petitions are legitimate. That's the process we're in right now. And as we head towards that June 28th primary, I'm afraid things may get a little uglier before we have that GOP candidate for governor.
If it ends up being Zeldin, a lot of people are not going to put the cart before the horse, but if it is him, what does he have to do to be competitive come November?
You know, he's doing well in the suburbs, if you will. We see Long Island, where he's from, and other regions where I think he'll perform well. The challenge, as always, is going to be, can he break 30 to 35% in New York City? That's where the fight, I believe, is ultimately going to come down.
And then finally, out of York County, Pennsylvania, I know you're keeping a close eye on this one, Michael. The vote at the school board meeting was 8-1 against this Satan Club for elementary school children. Yeah, I said it right. A Satan Club for school children there in York County. It was defeated, but a lot of folks are still kind of wondering how it even came up for a vote. What's happening there in York County?
Well, this was a mom who was upset that children in the elementary school there were being released in what's called release time with a ministry called Joy-El. It's been a historic practice in America for over 100 years, the release time. She, this woman who says she's not Satanist, she just believes in science and doesn't even believe in Satan, was looking for some alternative in this organization that does these Satan clubs. They say they don't believe in Satan either. That was her purpose in pushing this, really to shut down the opportunity for kids to learn about Christ.
So this school board decision, does this mean that if you're a Christian club and want to do an after-school activity, that's probably not going to happen either?
Well, I don't know if it's going to end up there. It's quite possible that a lawsuit will be filed now by the Satanist group because of this 8-1 decision against them opening their club. And where it goes from there, it depends on what the courts will do.
All right. Lots of interesting topics this week, but we're out of time, sadly. We'll have to end it there. But if you have questions about what's going on in New York State until the end of the session in June, Jason, you have a wonderful website where folks can go and check you out. What is that, sir?
AlbanyUpdate.com.
Stay informed as well on all the issues in Pennsylvania. Michael, where can folks find you?
PAFamily.org.